Thank you. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Please, we are seated. Just a few announcements today. This Thursday on the 27th, we've got our trick or beat at the ballpark. And I see we've got a good response with candy. We're probably going to make the amount we need. There's going to be like 3,000 kids there. So we've got to have about that much candy. So we're if not there, we're very close. What do I need from you guys today or Thursday, really? Prayer. Appreciate when the event starts, if you guys could be in prayer about the event itself, that we might be able to impact somebody and start conversations with folks. I have, since, you know, our elders are a bunch of slackers, right? It's me and the elders are going to pretty much do the event, since it's a late notice kind of thing. So that really is the most important, biggest thing that you can do for us on Thursday, is to specifically pray for the event, for that. And again, I want to thank you for your response with the candy as well. Next Sunday, we celebrate the Reformation. So after service, we're going to have a good old-fashioned meal. Again, brats and beverages and side dishes. And the side dishes depend on you guys. So whatever you bring, that's what we'll have. So you can check with me to see what my favorites are if you'd like. But we'll do that. And then immediately after the meal, we are going to view the movie Luther, the one that came out here more recently in the early 2000s, just to sort of get that history again for us. I think that'll be an enjoyable thing. Final announcement for today, anyway. Thanksgiving baskets. We've got that coming, too. It's just that season we're here. We hit the ground running. So there's a little different way we're going to do it. There's a sign-up sheet out in the connection area, and the deadline for it is the 13th. So Marilyn, anybody else that they can connect with? Well, grab Marilyn. If you got a question, specific question, she'll answer you. Okay? All right. So without further ado, let's rise and call in the name of the Lord. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all. Let's take a moment of silence here to think on God's word and the sin that we need to confess, the sin that we need to leave with Him. Let us approach the throne of grace with confidence, saying to the Lord, O Almighty God, merciful Father, we poor, miserable sinners confess unto you all our sins and iniquities, with which we have ever offended you, and justly deserve your temporal and eternal punishment. But we are heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them. And we pray you of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to us, poor sinful beings. Upon this your confession, and in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Having received peace with God, let us share that peace with each other. The Lord be with you. God really does delight in seeing this, but we need to continue. So we'll continue with the collect prayer of the day. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, you are always more ready to hear than we to pray, and always ready to give more than we either desire or deserve. Pour down on us the abundance of your mercy. Forgive us those things of which our conscience is afraid, and give us those good things for which we are not worthy to ask, except by the merits and mediation of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our psalm for the day is a selection from Psalm 116. What shall I render to the Lord for all his benefits to me? I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. O Lord, I am your servant. I am your servant, the son of your maidservant. You have loosed my bonds. I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people.
first reading today comes from Exodus chapter 24. Moses came and told all the people all the words of the Lord and all the just decrees. And all the people answered with one voice and said, "All the words that the Lord has spoken, we will do." And Moses wrote down all the words of the Lord. He rose early in the morning and built an altar at the foot of the mountain and 12 pillars according to the 12 tribes of Israel. And he sent young men of the people of Israel who offered burnt offerings and sacrificed peace offerings of oxen to the Lord. And Moses took half of the blood and put it in basins, and half of the blood he threw against the altar. Then he took the book of the covenant and read it in the hearing of the people. And they said, "All that the Lord has spoken, we will do, and we will be obedient." And Moses took the blood and threw it on the people and said, "Behold the blood of the covenant that the Lord has made with you in accordance with all these words." Then Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel went up. And they saw the God of Israel. There was under his feet, as it were, a pavement of sapphire stone, like the very heaven for clearness. And he did not lay his hand on the chief men of the people of Israel. They beheld God and ate and drank. This is the word of the Lord. The second reading today is from 1 Corinthians chapter 10. The cup of blessing that we bless, is it not a participation in the blood of Christ? The bread that we break, is it not a participation in the body of Christ? Because there is one bread, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of one bread. This is the word of the Lord.
Let us rise for the gospel verse. Return to the The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 14th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
On the first day of unleavened bread, when they sacrificed the Passover lamb, Jesus' disciples said to him, "Where will you have us go and prepare for you to eat the Passover?" And he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him. And wherever he enters, say to the master of the house, 'The teacher says, where is my guest room, where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' And he will show you a large upper room furnished and ready. There, prepare for us." And the disciples set out and went to the city and found it just as he had told them. And they prepared the Passover. And when it was evening, he came with the 12. And as they were reclining at table and eating, Jesus said, "Truly I say to you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me." They began to be sorrowful and to say to him one after another, "Is it I?" He said to them, "It is one of the 12, one who is dipping bread into the dish with me. For the Son of Man goes as it is written of him. But woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that man if he had not been born." And as they were eating, he took bread, and after blessing it, broke it and gave it to them and said, "Take, this is my body." And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank of it. And he said to them, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I say to you, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God." And when they had sung a hymn, They went out to the Mount of Olives. This is the gospel of the Lord. Grace, mercy, and peace be unto each of you from God our Father and our Lord, our King, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Let us pray. O Lord Jesus Christ, you are the light of the blind, the way for those who stray, and the resurrection of the dead. Bring us to repentance that we may approach your table with holy anticipation of the forgiveness of sins and the strengthening of our faith. Amen. You arrive home one Tuesday afternoon after a long day at work, or for you retired folks, a long day of whatever it is that you are doing. You pull up to the house, you stop at the end of the driveway, and you step out of your car to check the mailbox. And as you sort through the mail, you see the usual stuff. You know, a couple of bills, a few credit card offers, a flyer for a sale at the furniture place down the street. You also notice that there was a lawn care service that has placed a flyer in the mailbox without bothering to pay postage. Yeah, you sort of roll your eyes at their whole disrespect of the system, right? And that's when you spot it. something different, something special. An oversized envelope with a wax seal on the flap. It's heavy paper with an address inscribed in flowing calligraphy. It is stunningly beautiful. It exudes luxury and prestige. Now, there's no return address on it, but you can tell this is a special invitation. In fact, without even waiting to get in the house, you crack the seal and open the envelope. Inside is an engraved invitation to join the King of England for a grand banquet. Your travel arrangements have already been made. All expenses are covered, and you will travel first class. Now, before you can even consider what you have in the closet for such an event, you note that a gown, shoes, and accessories will be provided for you. You need only to show up. And when you call your boss to see if you can have a few days off, you're stunned to discover that your employer has already been notified and arrangements have been made to cover your responsibilities while you are away. Every little detail has been attended to. And a few hours later, you find yourself on a plane winging your way across the Atlantic. And when you arrive, you're whisked to a luxurious suite where you have a little bit of downtime to prepare for this amazing honor. And frankly, you're still a little unsure, but a quick look at the invitation says, yeah, this is indeed your name and address. It must actually be for you. And so you shower and you dress in the dazzling white gown that has been laid out in your room. And then you follow the instructions that were given, explaining where to find your table. And as you enter the room, you're surprised to find that you are not the only guest. The host has invited many people from all walks of life. And everyone gathers around the table to take their seats. Small conversations kind of pop up as people get to know one another. Common interests are discovered. There's great joy going on in this banquet hall. And everyone here admires the king, and they're overjoyed to be in his presence. This assembled group is full of kind, loving people, and all are made to feel that they're part of the group. Now, as the night goes on, though, no surprise, arguments pop up here and there. One person is angry that his neighbor took so much of the gravy for his potatoes. Another pair begins to argue about whether the crystal in use, is that really the best choice that they could have had here? One guy in the back's had a little too much of the wine, and he proceeds to try to belch out the alphabet. Yeah, you've been there, right? Another woman turns to her neighbor and point out somebody, look at her. I can't believe that's not the salad fork. As you look around the gathering, you may even begin to wonder if you belong there. I mean, the meal is so sumptuous. The environment is so luxurious. You doubt if this could possibly be meant for you. I mean, what in the world have you done to deserve such a gift? How could you ever repay such generosity? Now that you've conjured up that whole scene in your mind, let's shift a few details and tie it into our gospel. Of course, the invitation is not from the King of England. It's from someone far more important. The invitation you received is actually from the Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, the one by whom all things were made. And the venue is not some ritzy place in Great Britain. Frankly, beloved, it's the sanctuary of this very church. The table is no mahogany beauty, but is the humble place where we stand before the altar. And the group of people who have been invited as well, everyone around you, fellow members of this congregation, and also visitors from other congregations, and the whole sainted hosts of heaven and earth who come together for a foretaste of the feast to come. Well, how about those fancy clothes you're given at the beginning of the scenario? The ones to be worn at the banquet. Well, beloved, they are given, or they were given to you in your baptism. That is Christ's righteousness. That's what you are clothed in. I'm reminded of a story about Sir William Cecil. He was the one-time Lord Treasurer of England. When it came time to go to bed, he would take his official robe of the royal treasurer and he would throw it off onto a chair and he would say, "Lie there, Lord Treasurer," bidding adieu to all state affairs so he might have a good rest. So, beloved, when you live in your baptism, you put off the old self, which belongs to your former manner of life and is corrupt through deceitful desires. And you put on the new self, created after the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness. And so, clothed in his righteousness, we gather together today in response to an invitation that Christ has extended. The invitation is to return to the sacraments. That is, remembering our baptisms and that we are clothed in his righteousness, we return to the fellowship that we are part of as members of the body of Christ. And we return to this table to share in the joyous communion that we share together. In fact, Christ extends this invitation again and again, week after week, and he draws you to his table to feed you and to strengthen your faith and to nourish you in what he gave you in your baptism. Now, beloved, this is an exceedingly joyous feast, but it doesn't take long to see that it also is marred by sin. I mean, we are the chosen of God, but we also possess a sinful nature that infects everything. I mean, we sit at a table with some of the people who can't seem to control themselves, who can't seem to not look at someone else with, you know, what is that person? That is the wrong salad fork. How about the one who sings off key? Or the friend who failed to keep your secret last month and they betrayed you to a mutual acquaintance. You may even wonder, should you really even be here? I mean, at the Last Supper, Jesus revealed that one of his disciples would betray him, and it rippled through the whole group. I mean, is it I? Am I that messed up that I would do something like that? Beloved, you may wonder, you may doubt, but Christ has drawn you here, and he serves up this banquet all the same. He offers not just a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wine, of rich food full of marrow, of aged wine well-defined. No, it is much, much more than that. He offers you his very self, his very own body and his own blood. He offers the forgiveness of sins and life and salvation right in this holy meal. As Dr. Luther details in his explanation of the sacrament, in his small catechism, he says this. He says, where there is the forgiveness of sins, there is also life and salvation. And here, beloved, today, not only in the words of confession and absolution, but right here at this table today, we have the forgiveness of sins offered freely to you. And yes, this meal takes away your faults. This meal binds you more closely to your brothers and sisters in Christ. And more important, binds you closely to your Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. This meal covers your sins, strengthens your faith, and nourishes your body to serve God and to serve your neighbors. As we often pray here, Lord, bless us that we might be a blessing to others. Beloved, be sure of this. You belong here because Christ has won your seat at the table. Again, your baptism is your personalized invitation, and Christ's death and resurrection is the wax seal that authenticates it. No one can claim that you do not belong because your seat is guaranteed in Christ. He has promised it, and his promises are trustworthy and true. Now we rejoice in all that Christ gives us in the meal we will share. We give thanks then for his grace that invites us to his table, joins us in fellowship with one another, removes our sins, strengthens, and again nourishes us for service. But you know, as amazing as this meal is, never forget that this is merely a foretaste of what God has in store for you. You know, in our liturgical service, we sing that sometimes, right? Foretaste of the feast to come. This is sort of this little bit of bread you get, this little bit of wine that you get to sip, is just a teaser. I'm sorry. It's just a teaser for the feast to come. We should all shout with joy like that. Really, we should. You see, one day we are going to share a time when all the saints of God come together for that wedding feast of the Lamb and his kingdom, which has no end. Yes, we live in kind of a crazy now, but not yet. A time when we receive the benefits and the gifts God has given us today, right now. But we also know that what we experience today cannot hold a candle to what it will be on the last day. Today's gift sustains us and builds up our confidence in the feast to come. So, beloved, may you rejoice. May you rejoice in the gift of Holy Communion. May you shout with joy as you hold on to the promise of the full feast to come. Amen. And now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit, you may abound in hope. Amen. We continue our worship with our tithes and our offerings. Thank you. Let us confess our common faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. We rise. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to join the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For childlike hearts to receive the gifts of God at the gracious invitation of Christ, and for humility to pray with repentance and faith, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Let us pray to the Lord. For the church here and in every place, for pastors, that God would defend them from arrogance and pride and strengthen their preaching, and that all God's children would be united in saving faith. Let us pray to the Lord. For a deep care for the children entrusted to us, that we would defend their lives even before birth, for parents, our Lutheran schools, our public and private schools, Sunday schools, Bible classes, youth catechesis, that by them the little children would be brought to Jesus and preserved in the faith, and for humility to receive the kingdom of God like a little child. Let us pray to the Lord. That the leaders of the nations may abhor wickedness and boastfulness, fulfill their duties with diligence and humility, and govern in accordance with God's will. Let us pray to the Lord. For those who are near death, that God would preserve them from despair and give them a confident hope in the resurrection promises of our risen Lord. And for everyone in need, let us pray to the Lord. For those who come to this holy altar this day, that they would receive the very body and blood of Jesus in repentance and faith to their abundant blessing. Let us pray to the Lord. O Lord, if we trust in ourselves for righteousness, we are lost and dead in our sins. Yet you mercifully draw us to yourself in repentance and hear the cries of those who trust in your Son. Grant us humility, that we may not exalt ourselves or treat our brothers and sisters with contempt. Rescue us from every evil and bring us into your kingdom as your beloved children. To you alone be all glory, O Father, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever. Amen. O Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Brothers and sisters in Christ, the Apostle Paul admonishes us, let a person examine himself, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. Scripture hereby encourages us to come to the Lord's table, believing that Jesus Christ is himself present in the bread and the wine, as his words declare, this is my body, this is my blood. Scripture also encourages us to come trusting in the forgiveness of sins, as Jesus says, for you, for the forgiveness of sin. Finally, we are encouraged to do as Christ commands when he says, take, eat, drink. Do this in remembrance of me. When we repent, believe his words, and do as he commands, we come in a worthy manner and join the whole Christian church on earth in giving thanks to God the Father for our Lord Jesus Christ for so great a gift. We also pray that his love will renew our love for one another, and that we, with the whole Christian church, may know the comfort and joy that is in Christ, our Savior and Lord. Receive now his grace with believing hearts. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord is with you. These are God's gifts for God's people. He invites you to his table. We are seated. Let us rise for the table thanksgiving. Now may this, the true body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, strengthen you in the one true faith and to life everlasting, as you go in his peace and with his Spirit. Let us pray. God, our Father, whose Son, the light unfailing, has come from heaven to deliver the world from the darkness of ignorance, let these holy mysteries open the eyes of our understanding, that we may know the way of life and walk in it without stumbling. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Receive the Lord's blessings. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen. Go in peace, serve your King.